All right, in this one, I wanted to talk a bit about the sed command because a lot of its use is to search and replace in files, which is great for that. But it has also a lot of other things that are actually quite useful. And so I just wanted to quickly detail those here. And it's also a full Turing complete language. Like if you want, like people code Tetris in sed script, which is insane. You shouldn't do that, but it's powerful enough to do that, so it's quite nice. So as you can see here, I have a little file, the foo, where I just have a bunch of lines that are numbered as an example, and just some random line at the end. And so I will start to show you maybe the more advanced use of search and replace instead. So the basics of it is just you start with S, then some character, in my case slash, then I will say my regex, which will just be a word line, and I want to replace this by some hashtag characters. Let's give it the file foo as an argument. It can also, of course, like all utilities, take by the standard input instead of as an argument. That's not very surprising. And so you can see that it does what you expect, search line and replaced it with a few pound character. You will see though that if you, for example, do like just the letter E by a pound, you'll see that it only replaced the first instance of the match and not the second one. So the second E is left alone. You can change that by adding a number at the end of the substitute command. So for example, if I say two, it will only replace on the second match. So you can see here, second match. And this also works with any number. And the default is one, of course. You can also replace all the matches with G for global, I guess, which will replace all instances. This is a bit like the default behavior you would expect, but oh well. And so yeah, that's it. Of course, this can be a regex. So let's say num, then anything, then r. And you can see that it matched on all the numbers and it replaced them by what you want it to be replaced by. You can reference the thing that got matched with the ampersand character. So for example, if I want to put a number between quotes, I can say quote, ampersand, quote. And like so, you can see that number was just put between quotes at every instance, which is nice. What you can also do is there is a P flag, which stands for print. And so let's disable the default printing. So by default, sed will execute the command and print the output. But if you say dash n, it will disable that default behavior. But you can add a P flag to the substitute command. And here it will say basically print on everything that matched this. So you can see that some random line at the end didn't match and so didn't got printed. There's a similar flag called W, where you can say number better, whatever. So basically it will append all of the lines that matched, replace them, and then put them into the number better file or whatever you give as a file name. So yeah, it's basically the same thing we had before, but in a file. Besides that, that's about it for the search and for the substitute command. You can also have, for example, regex groups. Yeah, the groups look a bit weird. I will detail later, but you can refer to those groups by backslash and a number, like the number of the group. So here, I want the first group, so num, to be replaced, to be put between quotes. And well, if I remove the thing I had before, like so, and I put back the default printing, you can see that only num, the thing that was in the group, the regex group will match. But if I create a second group, like so, I can refer to this by backslash two, like so. And yeah, you can see that it basically works like just regular regex groups. Yeah, I mentioned that the regex are a bit weird. So for example, as well, like the base regex are a bit limited because of legacy reasons. For example, you don't have the plus. So plus will try to literally match the plus character. But if you have the dash uppercase E, it will enable extended regex, which are basically regular regex that you would expect on most things that implement regex. And also the groups are normal, you don't have to put backslash parentheses. So it's much cleaner. Generally, if you want like slightly complex regex, you very often use the dash E, although this is like a GNU extension, like the POSIX set doesn't have this. So if you want to make your stuff portable, it's you can't really use that flag. So yeah, I think that's about it for the search and replace for the substitute command, which is, yeah, as I said, probably the most useful. But as you can see, it has a few tricks up its sleeves. So next, we'll explain more the fundamental working of sed, which is that basically the syntax is that first you put a pattern and then you put a command. So previously our command was substitute, but there is other commands. For example, there is the command delete, which will delete a line. And basically the logic is if the line matches the pattern, it will apply the command. So let's say, and the pattern, for example, can be a regex. So let's say what number. And if I say D for delete, it will delete every single line that matches the pattern. And so the pattern can be a regex, but it can also be just a regular line number. So if I say 4D, it will delete the fourth line. You can see that the fourth line is not there. It can also have ranges of address. So if I say 4, 7, it will apply that command from the fourth to the seventh line, and it's an inclusive range. You can see it disappeared. You can mix line numbers and regex. So if I say up until the word, there is a line that matches the random pattern, so this one, it will delete those. And you can also have the dollar character, which will indicate the last line of the file. So you can see the some random line got deleted. That's about it for the addresses. And that's basically how you use the other commands. Like you generally want to filter some lines and then apply a command on them. So I already showed the delete command. There is of course the p command, which will print whatever matched the address. And so here in this case, there is the default printing as well. So it printed twice, but you can see that here is just basically print the last line of the file, which is not that useful, but it can be let's say I want only the third and seventh lines of a file. That's something. There is also, besides delete, there is a few commands to append text or to insert text. So let's say I for insert, and then you say something like hello. I have to re-enable printing, otherwise it will be strange, but it will basically, before each line, it will print whatever text you put in there. There's a similar one, which is A for append, so this will, same behavior, but it will print it after the line. There is finally the C. The reason I don't have a space is that if you have a space, it will, oh, well, on the GNU one, not. Like, it won't include the space. Sometimes it does, like, include spaces and stuff that you put in there. So, okay, but, okay, good to know. So, where was I? You can put the C for change, which will, if it's a range, it will change all the lines that match by only a single instance of the text. Replace the last line with a hello. That's what you would expect. There is A write. So very similarly to the write to a file thing that we saw in the substitute command, you have a W command. So if you say let's say anything that matches number, I want to write it to a file that is number, like so. And so if you cut number, it will include all the line that matched this pattern. There is also a read. So here you can do, like, let's say on line 4, I want to read the file, let's say the file foo, at that place. So you can see that it started to read and then it hit line 4, so it's the correct address, and then here it read the file into the output and then kept going. You can like, there is a cool one for debugging maybe sometimes your scripts, which is called L. And basically what it does, if I disable the default printing once again, it will print all the non-printable characters. So for example, the new line is represented by a dollar, but let's say I want to echo some other special characters into this. Oops, maybe not this. It will print them with backslashes and so, no, I have to put E. It will print them with backslashes instead of, if you have a regular print, it will just, output the characters themselves. So it will, escape the characters, the special characters, so that you can read them. There is one that is very similar to the TR command. If you know TR, it's to translate a character set to another character set. But it doesn't matter too much. I will quickly show you what it does. So if I say still on the file foo, so if I say y, and then let's say I want to replace ABC by some symbols, whatever. So here the A will be replaced by at, B will be replaced by hashtag, and so on. So you can see how it worked here and here. There is also a cool one to print the line number. So this will print the line number, and then it will proceed with the rest. And yeah, that's about it for the most basic commands. There is more advanced stuff for, like, you can switch buffers and have branching and so on, which makes it Turing complete, as I said, but that's a bit too advanced. I should mention that the POSIX one doesn't have this, but the GNU one has the I option, which means in place. So it will, instead of outputting it to the standard output, it will modify the file in place. Well, now I have a bunch of garbage in my file. Oh well. If you're not on a GNU system, I would recommend using the Sponge utility. So what it does, Sponge is really nice. It's part of More Utils, if you know. You can Google it. And it will basically take everything on stdin and write it to a file, which is quite handy. So yeah, there is also one that is a bit nice called N, which will go to the next match. Well, I think I need to clean my file a bit now, because it's gonna be a pain otherwise. Yeah. So by itself, it just goes to the next line, which is not very useful, but so if you want to skip a line at some point, like let's say 4, maybe that's not a great way to explain it, but okay, fine. That comes more in when you go do more advanced stuff. But there is the uppercase N, which is a bit more useful. So what it will do, by default you don't see the difference, but basically what it will take the next line and concatenate it to the current line. And so, now there is this, still the backslash n between those two stuff that are concatenated. So it still prints as usual, but if after you do a replacement on the backslash n, and then you replace it by, let's say, comma, whatever, you can see that it just concatenated every line. Well, every two lines got concatenated, which is kind of neat. Like, I use it often if I want to pair my file with the line number. So you could say, like, I think print equal, then n, then this. I forgot how to do it. But I think there is a way to do it, maybe, like said, equal to, yeah, that's getting a bit more complex, but I just want to quickly see if I can do it. Okay, nice. So I can prefix all the line by their number, which is kind of neat. I think there is a way to do it that is not does not include two set command, because that's a bit strange, but you see my point. Kind of neat. So yeah, I think that's about it. I hope you learned something, and that is quite nice. Please tell me if you want me to do a video for on the more complex feature, like branching. So but for the basics of it, you can have like scopes, and you can have labels. So like this, if you have two dots, then a word, it becomes a label in your code. And then you can use the T and the B command, which is, well, somewhere. And you can branch to that label with a condition. So yeah, let me know if you want a video on that. But I think for most people, it's really not that useful. So that's why I don't include it. I hope you like the, I don't know, I call it the Swiss Army knife of the terminal, because it's useful for all kinds of little things. So yeah, I hope you enjoyed it, and see you in the next one.